Hello and welcome to We Caribbean, a special program in which we discuss and analyze the issues affecting the region, giving a voice to those who are impacted. It's their issues, their concerns, their triumphs on We Caribbean. I'm your host, Doris Folo. The Anguilla Progressive Movement, APM, headed by Dr. Ellis Webster, won the June 29th general election in the British Overseas Territory. The APM was victorious in seven constituencies, taking over from Premier Victor Banks, whose Anguilla United Front won four seats. An estimated 11,950 voters were eligible to cast their ballot. 32 candidates representing the two main political parties, along with 10 independents, contested the polls. So this is the dawn of a new era for Anguilla. And to tell us more about this, we have you who you were recently sworn in as tourism minister. And my first question to you, since Anguilla's 1969 secession from St. Kitts and Nevis, politics on the island has been a contest between Ronald Webster and his political rivals. How would you say has politics changed between then and now?
Politics has evolved significantly between then and now. Then it was a revolution. It was a revolution to secede from the Treaty Island Federation of St. Kitts, Nevis, Anguilla. Even just after, immediately after the revolution, Anguilla actually embarked upon a referendum and became an independent republic. Soon thereafter, as you know, history tells us that we were invaded 2 months after becoming an independent republic. And in 1976, we had our first election under the new constitution, which allowed for seven electoral districts. Now, that is when the father of the nation, the leader of the revolution, the Honorable James Ronald Webster, came to office as the first chief minister. Some years later, about 5 years later, he was really and truly out of local politics. So politics have continued to evolve since then. And in 2019, our constitution was changed to allow for us to retain the seven district representatives along with four island-wide candidates. So the House was expanded. The House was expanded to 11 elected representatives, along with two ex officio members, which would be the deputy governor and the attorney general. There is still room for constitutional change where the House may be expanded to two more elected representatives and the removal of the ex officio members. So prior to 2020, there were two nominated members in Anguilla's parliament. So there are no longer any nominated members for Anguilla's parliament. Everybody in the parliament are now elected. So that is a fundamental change. Our parliament now has three persons under the age of 30, three elected in the first time in history. We have a 25-year-old and two 27-year-old elected representatives. One of those elected representatives is the Honorable Minister of Education, Youth and Culture and Sports, the Honorable Deanne Kentish Rogers, who unseated the former premier, who was a political figure in Anguilla for over 40 years.
That brings me to a question that I had for you, because I was wondering with that sort, I mean, that was definitely a big feat. Not only did she get elected into office, but she also outseated, as you mentioned, the former premier. So, I mean, what does that say for your political party in terms of giving an opportunity for young people to make policy decisions?
Well, from the very outset, we were keen about having young people sit at the table. Not sit at the table as a token, but have a meaningful seat at the table. And when we embarked upon this campaign, a lot of people at the very beginning were skeptical, because it has always been said that young people, political party after political party, government after government have said, young people during the election cycle, young people will take a meaningful role. And they have not had young people sit as it relates to candidates, and afterwards they would say, wait your turn, wait until next time. But we embark on a concerted effort to ensure that young people were recruited, and a number of us, let us put this this way. In 2010, I was the youngest member of parliament. And now, 10 years later, I'm one of the oldest members of parliament.
What a change.
What a change in just one decade. So it goes to show you. three of the members of parliament right now were in high school 10 years ago.
Wow.
That says a lot.
The young people. How are campaigns and rallies different this time around? We've seen mobilizations strictly online due to restrictions imposed to stem the spread of COVID-19 mm-hmm. in Anguilla. Tell us about that.
Well, we initially embarked upon the regular political rallies. But in March, once COVID arrived to our shores, we shut the island down. And with that, a lot of restrictions came into being. And with that, we had to go completely online, digital platforms and what have you. But the thing is that before the shutdown, when we embarked upon this political campaign, it was digital as well. So the only thing that changed is that we removed the public rallies, the physical rallies, and replaced them with digital, just purely digital. So that was the only difference for us. So for us, it was a very smooth transition.
What would you say are the issues that are of main priority?
The issues of main priority right now is just keeping our head above water during this COVID crisis. Because as you know, Anguilla has always been a tourism-based economy, has always been. And so some people like to give numbers in terms of how many people work in the hospitality sector. I like to say everybody does, because I grew up in an Anguilla where the tourism sector was just getting off the ground and we didn't have any economy at all. We are basically subsistence farming and fishing. But today we have a very vibrant economy. We have a very high standard of living. And so when all the hotels and villas and the industry shut down in March, in the time when people were making the most money, it came at a blow. So, of course, one of the things that we are embarking on right now, we just recently passed to extend unemployment benefits to the entire population. So this is what we are doing right now, just to keep people above water until that time comes. Now, the thing is that we don't know when that is going to come. We don't make the determination. COVID is making those determinations for us. So that is a challenge, and how we can smartly and safely open the economy without the adverse risk of having COVID enter our shores again.
Yeah, because you just mentioned that tourism is a very important sector for the country. And I mean, you mentioned also having to be smart in reopening the sector. But what can be done really going forward in the course of this pandemic? Because the economy needs to survive. So what is the government's plan as it relates to that?
Well, right now, we are looking at those countries that fall under 0.02% of transmission. And we are looking at those countries as the more desirable places. We are rolling out a package very shortly where persons who are allowed to work from home can come to Anguilla. You'll have to apply and you have to go through certain protocol of testing and quarantine once on arrival for a period of time of 14 days. And once you're given all clear, you're allowed to mingle around in the community and also work from home. We believe that we can facilitate that. That can give us a little jump start in terms of our economy. And also for those prospective destinations that will be approved, high net worth persons who, can travel private to Anguilla. That is a big part of our tourism product. So, that is where we're going to be going. And we'll be rolling that out very shortly. I'm talking within a matter of a week.
Oh, wow. So this is actually targeted towards regional tourists, or because I know the Barbados Prime Minister, she made mention of something similar prior.
Yes.
But that one was actually geared towards foreigners. And I mean, they definitely have hardest hit by COVID-19. So who is this geared toward?
Well, this is geared towards those persons who are, in the digital economy, mostly those who are engaged in the digital economy, and also those high net worth persons who want to get away and don't mind being quarantined on the beach. We have some of the world's best beaches, and you being quarantined on the beach, I mean, what can beat that?
That brings me to a question, because Antigua and Barbuda's Prime Minister made certain declarations that while they have opened their economy to foreigners, some people have been fabricating the test results. How do you ensure that Anguilla remains COVID-19 free if there's the possible threat of people not being totally honest in terms of their status?
Well, we persons are not going to be able to just jump on a plane and come to Anguilla. We don't have any capacity for transatlantic commercial traffic. There's only, we don't have, we have an international airport, yes, but it's only geared towards private jets and small inter-regional flights. So that in itself reduces that scope. We're not opening the island. We are allowing people on a application process and a needs be process to be processed by us, to be vetted by us before we allow them to come to Anguilla. So even if you are interested in coming to Anguilla, you're not just going to book a flight and come to Anguilla. You're going to go through a rigid process of testing of a certain protocol. And even when on arrival, you won't be allowed to go freely. You'll be in quarantine. You'll be driven directly to the facility. You'll be in quarantine for that particular, restricted for that particular period. And you'll be tested on arrival. You'll be tested 10 to 14 days later. So if you fake your test in whichever destination you're coming from, you're not going to fake the test in Anguilla. But apart from that, we are not allowing persons from the United States to come to Anguilla at this time. Because as you know, we know what we know about the United States.
Most definitely. We'll take a short break now, Minister Hughes. And when we come back, we'll continue our discussion on tourism in Anguilla and what this new government has in store for their country. Stay with us.
Hola, quiero mandarles un cálido abrazo a los compañeros y compañeras de Telesur que están cumpliendo 15 años de vida. Se ha convertido en este tiempo en un medio central para comunicar desde el sur global, para comunicar las miradas de los pueblos de nuestra América Latina. Así que un abrazo muy, muy grande y por muchos años más de vida.
Bien, adiós. طلعنا على الشارع هناك وهدموا البيوت وجرفوهن
ونحن كشعب وكمقاومة لا يمكن أن
Welcome back. We're continuing our conversation with Anguilla's Tourism Minister Hayden Hughes to discuss the current situation in the country amid the global pandemic. Earlier, we were discussing tourism in Anguilla. I want to return to that question and ask you, how difficult would you say it is to manage Anguilla's economy going forward? But realistically speaking as well, are there plans to diversify and to try and encourage people to find other ways of making money and generating income amidst the pandemic?
Yeah, there are plans already afoot for us to look at different policies and regulations, legislation to diversify the economy. There are also regulations that we are policy and regulations, legislation to decriminalization. But also we're looking at a manufacturing policy, manufacturing legislation, so we can embark on small, light manufacturing in Anguilla. But one of the things that we must not run away from, at the end of the day, Anguilla, like most of the Caribbean, does not print money. We rely on foreign income coming to Anguilla. And in the diversification of the economy during this COVID period, where new dollars are coming in, is going to be a challenge. One of the things that we're embarking upon, because I'm also the minister responsible for ports, infrastructure, housing, telecommunications, electricity, water, public utilities. So I am also embarking upon, we're looking at how we can green Anguilla in terms of moving towards renewable energy and renewable energy integration. This is something that is going to be a huge platform for us because we spend too much money on fossil fuels to generate electricity in Anguilla. So there's a number of policy initiatives, there's a number of projects that we're embarking upon to make the cost of governing lower, to reduce the cost of governing. So that in itself should be able to free up more money for infrastructure projects and also for social projects, social development projects. But as it relates to the diversification of the economy, we are moving to digital. We are doing a lot of digital stuff. We are, as I said before, we are embarking on policies to create a manufacturing industry. Some of the areas that we are really going towards in terms of diversification is farming and fishing. We have the parliamentary secretary, the Honorable Quincy Gomes Marie, who herself is under the age of 30 and elected. She was elected as well. And she is tasked with that responsibility, the green industry, the blue industries, and also to really push ahead in terms of the fishing industry, because Anguilla has some of the largest fishing grounds, if not the largest fishing grounds in the entire Caribbean. We have 200 nautical miles of ocean territory, and that in itself is significant, and it hasn't been exploited, at least not by us. So some of the things that we want to do, we want to look at offering fishing licenses that will bring foreign capital into Anguilla. We are also in support of fishing, local fishing. There's a company in Anguilla, a local company that is embarking upon a large fishing trawler that can go out and exploit those waters. So that in itself will offer a number of industries to us in terms of a fish processing plant. And if we can export some of our goods, because we have tuna in abundance, we have mahi in abundance, we have lobster in abundance. I mean, 200 nautical miles, over 200 nautical miles can tell you what we, you know, the capacity that we have over there. Mm-hmm. So this is something that I think from a tourism standpoint is also a marketing tool, because when you export something that says made in Anguilla, that in itself creates some eyeballs to say, hey, where's Anguilla? Because for the most part, some of us still may not know where Anguilla is.
Most definitely. And I mean, shifting our attention now back to the recent elections that was held last month. I mean, how did the Anguilla Progressive Movement sell itself to the people? I mean, especially because there were so many young candidates vying for positions. And then you won, I believe, 7 out of the 11 seats. That was significant. How were you guys able to do that?
And the seats that we lost, they were very narrow losses. One of our candidates lost by 16 votes, one lost by 40 votes, and the other lost by 23 votes. So the losses were very close. So that says a lot, that the losses were close, but the wins were significant. But the truth of the matter is that all of our candidates were known. We have been known. I have been doing radio talk show. And I'm a former junior minister of tourism. I've been doing radio talk show for almost 2 decades. So I am known. The Honorable Deanne Kendish Rogers, she was an athlete representing Anguilla. She was also Miss Universe Great Britain and participated in the Miss Universe pageant, who was one of the top 20 finalists in Miss Universe. She's well known. All of our candidates were already well known. So it's easy to sell people who are already well known by the entire populace. So that in itself gave us a real advantage. And I think Dr. Webster was very careful in vetting each candidate to ensure that the negatives were as low as possible. And that in itself lent to the credibility of the entire process. And people sometimes judge you from your record, your personal record, your professional record. And when you say something, they judge you against that record. We were able to say, hey, look at our personal lives. Look what we have been able to accomplish outside of politics. And give us this opportunity, we'll be able to do it inside of the realms of parliament, where you have the power to enact legislation, you have the power to draft policy that can benefit the lives and create opportunities for the people.
Most definitely. I mean, a spotlight was placed on Anguilla following the murder of Kenny Mitchell by Scott Hapgood. And then 14 months later, I mean, is this a point of contention for your government? And then, I mean, of course, you as tourism minister, because there have been calls to have him extradited to the island to face the charges, but nothing has really come out of that.
Well, it's not a point of contention for our government, because as you would appreciate, I was one of the leading proponents for the for him having been extradited. I was one of the leading proponents for him not even leaving the island to begin with. And I spent a good time on my political, not on my political platform, but my radio talk show and other vehicles, social media platforms. I did interviews with NBC and CBS and a number of different US-based publications and news outlets on this particular issue. So now I am in government, and it's, of course, without a shadow of a doubt, it's something that I would be pushing for very strongly, because I believe that he should never have left Anguilla's shores. I believe he should be here to face justice, and that will not rest with me. So it's not a point of contention. It's something that we're going to be pushing forward with.
I mean, most definitely. But I mean, why was he even allowed to leave the country?
There's something called white privilege.
Definitely.
People will be afraid to say it. And maybe some of my political colleagues would be afraid to say it, but if you know me and if you have done your research, you'll know that I say it as it is. You know, I have to practice some political correctness now, but I have that part of me have not evaporated. But there was a certain amount of privilege that came along with him being allowed that privilege. And I can tell you, if it was a Caribbean brother, was an American, African-American, he would not have been where he is today. He would have been sitting firmly in Her Majesty's prison in Anguilla.
So are you confident that with yourself and the activism, I mean, taking place in Anguilla, and then what we see with Black Lives Matter protests in the United States, and then that spread across the world, are you confident that, you know, Scott Hapgood will be extradited back to Anguilla to face charges?
I will not stop. I'm very confident, because I don't think that anybody should suffer the injustice that Kenny Mitchell has suffered, and we will not stop until he's here to face justice. The thing is that Anguilla have a very good judicial system. He has no fear about a biased judicial system, and if he was truly innocent, he would volunteer himself to be here. He had never faced any risk of personal harm while he was here. He or his family, we are not a people who does that. And even after this incident, he was free to walk around, moved around without any fear. So in terms of his personal safety, he has nothing to fear. But in terms of justice, he has to be here.
Yeah.
He must be here.
Now, turning our attention, now we are in the midst of the hurricane season. And I believe the last hurricane to affect Anguilla would have been Irma in 2017, Category 5 strength. How's this government preparing for the possibility of such a disaster going forward at this time?
Well, we're in the midst of the hurricane season, but we are part of the hurricane zone. We are part of the hurricane belt. We're not as privileged as you are to be living outside of that belt. But since 1960, we have been building with the expectation of a hurricane, because in 1960, Hurricane Donna hit Anguilla in September of that year, and 7 people died. And in 1995, we had Hurricane Lewis and Hurricane Maria that really devastated Anguilla, and we bounced back soon thereafter. We had Hurricane to throw that between that period in 2017, but in 2017, that was a monster, and we survived. And I'm sitting right here in my home, which had minimal damage, even though there are some persons who are not as privileged as I am. But we are always ready for hurricanes. We are always ready for hurricanes. So I have no fear about that whatsoever. We are always ready. Now, it's a whole different situation because we have the pandemic, the global pandemic. So how we recover after the pandemic is going to be interesting to see. But we are always ready, physically ready for hurricanes.
Minister, your closing comments to our viewers, you're free to plug your invitation to COVID-19 free Anguilla as well.
Well, you're getting a personal invitation, so your invitation is secured. So don't lose your invitation before I change my mind.
Of course, I'm there. I mean, blue seas is all I need, and that's it. I'm there.
Yeah, people really want to get away. People really want to get away from their particular situations, especially those people in Europe. Right now, we are going to be doing some heavy marketing into Canada and certain countries into Europe, which falls under 0.02%. That is where we're going to be pushing right now. We're going to, as I said before, we're going to evaluate every application on a case-by-case basis. And hopefully soon we will be able to open to North America in a careful very careful and calculated manner. But that is the way it's going to be. Unfortunately, I can't just have a full-fledged pitch to come to Anguilla at this point, because that is not exactly what we want. It's kind of crazy to think that here I am as a Minister of Tourism and not being able to say, come to Anguilla, you know?
Yeah.
And that's just the reality of the times that we are living in. And unfortunately, when we open, it's not going to be determined by us, but it's going to be determined by COVID-19. And until then, just keep your eyes open and keep your ears open, but you'll be hearing a lot from Anguilla as we move forward.
Of course, and I hope I can be there on the ground to see it myself. Minister Hughes, Tourism Minister of Anguilla, thank you so much for joining us.
You're most welcome. Thank you very much.
The state of affairs in all Caribbean countries remains one of serious concern, dependent on tourism, yet battered by the COVID-19.
So much for joining us.
You're most welcome. Thank you very much.
The state of affairs in all Caribbean countries remains one of serious concern, dependent on tourism, yet battered by the COVID-19 pandemic. Of course, we'll continue to keep an eye on these issues affecting the region. To keep up with news and more, join us on social media. For Telus English, I am Doris Polo. Thank you so much for watching.